Good morning and welcome to Grace United Methodist Church on this beautiful Sunday morning, our first Sunday in May. So even though we've passed May Day already, it's still May Day Sunday, right? Will you find your seats and bookmark your conversations and pick up on those during fellowship time following worship over in Grace Hall with some goodie treats and coffee and other refreshing beverages. Pray with me, please. Gracious, loving, heavenly Creator, Father God, we come into your presence today with some hearts that are heavy, with burdens that are known to them and to you. But Lord, those hearts have come here today to lay those burdens at your feet, so that we are unburdened and ready to carry your message and do your work in the world. Others are here, Lord, with praise and thanksgiving for joy that's also brought here to lay at your feet to praise you and thank you. Lord, with all these things, we are promised that you carry those burdens just as your son Jesus carried that cross, so that we don't have to do that. Father God, we pray that all that we do and say here today brings glory to you, encouragement to us, and a message to others. In Jesus' precious holy name we pray, amen. Amen. I pray you have a powerful experience of our Lord and Savior Jesus through worship today. And let's begin with singing, "Lord, I Lift Your Name on High." Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my death to pay. From the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky, Lord, I lift your name on high. I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Amen. May we always be lifting his name on high. May I have the joy now to share that Alex Mork has, not so graciously, but has agreed to do our reflection connection today. Thank you, Alex.
Thank you, Alex.
Okay. So I was asked today to pretty much do reflection, and I really didn't think about it too much. And so my mom gave me the idea of, why not talk about what Mother's Day means to you? And so with Mother's Day coming up just next week on Sunday, I figured, you know, I can talk about this. So first of all, how many of the people in the congregation are mothers? Okay, pretty much all of you. All right. So I just, if you want to, you can share, but how many of you want to share what Mother's Day means to you? Any of you? Okay. Well, to me, Mother's Day shouldn't just be Mother's Day. It should be Mother's Month or Mother's Year, because they do a lot to put time and effort into what their sons and daughters want to do. And they support us. They support us all. And they're so kind, so friendly, so loving, that maybe we should start showing even more respect than what we do currently to our mothers and start doing things more and more for them. And so I figured, you know, why not start? And so I'm kind of, for me personally, I'm going to start changing things to where I start doing more and more for my mother for all she's done, because she loves me and cares for me. And when I started talking about this, the first thing that came to mind was all those people in San Francisco, all those homeless. And what really hit me was, wow, these people might not have any parents left. They might not be cared for and loved too much. And so I kept thinking, I'm just happy to have a family who actually cares about me and loves me, especially my mother.
And I have to follow that.
Thank you, Mom.
Thank you, Wanda, for asking me to ask Alex. Thank you, Alex. We may not have a large youth contingent at our church as far as numbers, but our youth are amazing. And each of you have that opportunity to parent them, whether you're their blood parents or not. And I appreciate what you have done for my son and for the youth in our church. I believe that this church is our family. And there's so many other things that I believe too. And so let's sing about the things that we believe about God with the song, We Believe. In this time of desperation, you can turn it down a little.
When all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe. We believe. In this broken generation, when all is dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe. We believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit.
and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe.
So
let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations, we believe. We believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. Let the lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. Let love invade, let the church live loud. Our God will say, we believe, we believe. And the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. Now we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection. And he's coming back. He's coming back again. He's coming back again. Amen. What a powerful, powerful Lord and Savior we have. And there's so many ways that we can share that with others and with ourselves as well. And so Linda is going to come and share our announcements in ways that we can minister to others and amongst ourselves in our community, right? Thank you, Linda.
Good morning. Is this on? Is it on? Okay. I'm Kathy today. Kathy's out of town. So thank you. there's a UMM-sponsored Mother's Day breakfast on May 14th at 8:30 in Grace Hall. Women are free, and there's a free will offering for others. Don't forget the Day of Giving, which is May 12th from 8 to 5 at the Kiwanis Community House, and supports Cheyenne organizations. Bring donations, bring your blood, give your blood, and recycle. And don't forget to sign up for our yard sale. All the sign-up sheets are out there. I'm really looking at a lot of help so that we can continue this. It's June 2nd and 3rd, but we will have a members-only sale Thursday evening. So you can all come and bring what you bought last year and sell and donate it and buy something else to donate. So it's kind of recycling the whole thing. And then another quick announcement. The UMM or the UMW unit meeting was yesterday, and they had Tupperware. They were selling Tupperware, and Michelle Schumann's donating all the proceeds from that sale to us to buy new water pitchers for Grace Hall. There are catalogs next door, so if you would like to look at a catalog and place an order, Michelle, can they contact you? Michelle, can they contact you with the order? I think she's going to close the show on Tuesday, but I'm not positive. So if you want something, give Michelle a call. And also, there's 31 bags, and this is Val Zeman's granddaughter. She's also donating part of the proceeds to that project. So there is a catalog next door for that. And just a quick note, you're doing great on collecting batteries. The last time I went, I had an old fire extinguisher. And, you know, you don't, they're too expensive to refill. And so what do you do with them? But they do take them. So if you would like to bring old fire extinguishers, just kind of let me know so that they don't stack up in the corner. Somebody told me that, Juanita, did you tell me that you had one since the house was built? I don't think it's any good anymore. But that's a good way to get rid of them. Is this, I'll take them out to the transfer station with the batteries. Okay, any other announcements? Oh, I got two birthdays. Barbara Turk, and I asked her if she is on the 8th, and I asked her if she felt any older today, and she said no. So good. And Brandy Nash is on the 14th, so wish them a happy birthday. Thank you.
Sweet hour of prayer. Oh, how beautiful. Thank you, Sarah, for sharing with us. Will you please stand and join me in our call to worship? Christ is risen. God is alive. Hope is alive.
New life is within us.
The church is alive.
God's Spirit is within us.
We come to celebrate our God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Let us remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, A Mighty Fortress is Our God. It's found in the Pew Bible, hymn number 110, and we're going to do verses 1, 2, and 4.
A mighty fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amid the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe doth seek to hurt us woe. His craft and Christ Jesus, it is He.
Seated. Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verses 23 through 31. And this is from the Common English Bible translation. After their release, Peter and John returned to the brothers and sisters and reported everything the chief priests and elders had said. They listened, then lifted their voices in unison to God. "Master, you are the one who created the heaven, the earth, the sea, and everything in them. You are the one who spoke by the Holy Spirit through our ancestor David, your servant. Why did the Gentiles rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth took their stand, and the rulers gathered together as one against the Lord and against his Christ. Indeed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, with Gentiles and Israelites, did gather in this city against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and plan had already determined would happen. Now, Lord, take note of their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with complete confidence. Stretch out your hand to bring healing and enable signs and wonders to be performed through the name of Jesus, your holy servant." After they prayed, the place where they were gathered was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began speaking God's word with confidence. Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Now I'd invite our children to come forward for children's moments.
There we go. I'm going to ask you a question. Do you know what a cliche is?
No.
Do you know what a cliche is?
No.
Do you know what a cliche is? No. It's like a donut. Yeah, it goes around and around and around, doesn't it? So saying that people say when they don't know what else to say. I'm going to read a few to you. Hold on. I have to get to the right place here. You'd think as old as I am, I'd know a few of these, but you know what? I don't say them anymore. But I do say this one once in a while because things just happen. And I say, I'm in the wrong place at the wrong time. Like when somebody wins the lottery and I see that they got it at the station I was just at, and I said, shoot, I should have bought a lottery ticket. Nah, I was just in the wrong place at the wrong time. No matter what. You ever say that? No matter what. Yeah, that's a cliche. We all make mistakes. Do you make a mistake?
Yeah.
You?
Yes.
Yeah. Do you make a mistake, Karen? Do you make mistakes? Yeah, we all make mistakes, right? One thing after another. If it's going to go wrong, it's going to go wrong. Well, today we're going to talk about one. It's really simple. It's called, it's not rocket science. You've heard somebody say that?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not rocket science. Well, do you remember back on Easter, we were all given flower seeds? Yeah. What did you do with your flower seeds?
I put them on my auntie's desk so she could plant them.
Yeah. We just didn't take them out and sprinkle them in the ground, did we? Because what do you have to do to the ground to make flowers grow? Can you guys tell me?
Bury the flower seeds and water it.
Oh, did you hear what she said? Say it again.
Bury the flower seeds and water them.
And water them. Oh, so I can't just sprinkle them on the ground and they'll grow. No, I've got to water them. What else do I have to do to them? You know?
Make sure they get sunlight.
Make sure they get sunlight. So I don't want to plant them in the shade, do I? So I just can't go out on the shady side of the house and just throw them out there, right? No. You see, planting flowers is not rocket science. Do you know what it takes to be a rocket scientist?
You have to keep on testing things.
Yeah. Do you like science? Well, see, I don't like science. I'd not make a rocket scientist because rocket science takes a lot of science. You have to learn about how to build a rocket so it'll fly. Then you have to make sure that the rocket you build is big enough to go through the atmosphere. Then you have to know how to make rocket fuel. So you have to keep testing it. But planting flowers is not rocket science, is it? It's just a few simple steps to make the flowers grow. You know, that's kind of like our faith. If when we accept Christ as our Lord and Savior, and we don't do anything else, what will happen to our faith? It'll be nothing. It'll just kind of wither away and die like those flowers I planted in the shade, huh? So we've got to nurture our faith, don't we? We have to come to church and listen to Reverend Laura, and we have to go to Sunday school when we're at all ages. I keep saying Sunday school is for children, but it's not. It's for all ages because we can always learn something new. We have to read our Bible every day, don't we? Even if it's just one verse, we need to open that book and read it. So we have to nurture our faith, don't we, for it to grow. We need to kind of plant it in the sunshine, right? And we need to water it and feed it. Do you remember the water that Jesus talked about? Was it water from a water fountain?
No.
No. Did you hear? No. Jesus said to drink the water that he gives because you'll never thirst again. And if we fill ourselves with his word and we learn it, we can always fall back on it, even when we don't have a Bible, can't we? It's kind of like the 23rd Psalm. I think most of the adults in here, or I should say some of them, should know that by heart. That's the easy one. I fall back on that one a lot. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Karen even knows it. See, that's how we do it. We put it on our heart. We put it in our souls so that we can pull on it when we come across those hard times. It's not rocket science. It's just faith and love in God and Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love and the life of your Son, the life he gave for us. We thank you for leaving the Holy Spirit here to guide us and direct us, and for the sunshine that we may grow in your love and understanding. We pray all this in his holy name. Amen.
get ready for communion over here. Well, poor Emma, she's like, what? You said my name. Her father did study to be a rocket scientist. Did you know that? Your dad got his degree in aerospace engineering, went into the ministry, and I think he's still arguing with God why he had to do all that science if he wasn't going to actually create rockets or anything like that. And then I have to tell you, as you were talking about plants and scattering seeds, if only dandelions weren't so good at just having their seeds scattered. Anybody else have a yellow lawn like me? And it doesn't matter how you pick them, they come back. They come back. So anyway, did you say bees? I think bees are part of your family, but that's a different story. As we get into our time together, as we reflect on who the Holy Spirit is for us, would you please pray with and for me? Let us pray. Holy God, may your Holy Spirit be with us, among us, inside us, and around us. And may we be connected to your will, to your love, and to your grace through these words, through our time together. Amen. So we are in the midst of our study of the Apostles' Creed, and hopefully you all have a card. If you didn't bring it back, that's okay. We have a few extras if you never got one. Or if you really just don't want to figure it out, page 882 in your hymnal, but you don't have to get that out yet. So we've studied, we've talked about God the Father. We've talked about God in Jesus Christ. And today we're talking about whom? Holy Spirit. Yay, there it is. There's the answer. So before we get into the Holy Spirit, I'm going to kind of say that the Holy Spirit is God speaking to us today. But before we get that, I want you to turn to somebody next to you and answer the question, have you ever felt God speaking to you or felt a nudging or something that you knew was God? And so I'll give you a couple of minutes to share with your neighbor or your three neighbors, however you want to do that. Well, some of you are still talking, and some of you are like, let's get on with it. I've got breakfast to go to. So think about it. You don't have to raise your hands, but for some of you, I said, name a time that you felt God speaking to you or nudging you, and you went, I know the exact time. Some of you went, well, maybe. Maybe it was a while. Let me think about that. Who's right and who's wrong? Well, that's a trick question, isn't it? One of the things, I've been using the book from Adam Hamilton, The Apostles' Creed, What Christians Believe and Why. And one of the things he says is, especially United Methodists, we've gotten into a head faith. We're really good at talking about God, learning about God, taking classes about God, but how do we experience God? And if we talk about Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, most United Methodists that I know, and others too, not just United Methodists, we're really good at talking about God, the Creator, and Jesus Christ, but the Holy Spirit is a little different. Did you know that the Holiness Pentecostal movement came out of the United Methodist Church? Whether you grew up or went or have been to a Pentecostal church, it's a lot different than our sit down, listen to what the pastor has to teach us to our head. Anybody ever been to a Pentecostal or holiness or charismatic church? It's a lot livelier. They don't worry about bulletins. They don't worry about time. Why? Because they're waiting on the Holy Spirit to show up. And they're waiting and experiencing the Spirit, whatever that might be. When we were in Laramie, we were at First United Methodist Church in Laramie, and of course it's very academic because you have lots of professors and educators over there. But we had this new professor. She was an assistant professor, actually from England, Great Britain, not London. I don't remember what community she was from. But she grew up in more of a charismatic type church. But her theology was changing, so she was experiencing different church theology, so she really appreciated our Methodist church there. But she said, what would happen if somebody in the church stood up and said, the Spirit has given me a message that I have to preach to you right now, and it wasn't the pastor? She said, how would your church respond? Besides freaking out, besides somebody going, shh, we don't do that here. Now, I have to say, between other churches I've been at and Grace, I think Grace could handle it better than other churches I've been at. So when we talk about it, the Holy Spirit is God present right now in us, around us, working among us. It's so easy for us to keep in that head, what does the Bible teach? What should we believe? How should we talk about it? But instead of experiencing it. So in a way, the Holy Spirit connects us to the heart of God. I don't think this is in my notes either. But the Holy Spirit is God's presence with us. But yet, it's not something that we don't have to think about it. Instead, I think we should start integrating more what we think and what we say to how we act and how we experience. Because if we look at this book right here, the Holy Bible, there is a lot about the Holy Spirit. If you were to count up all the references, and I didn't count them up, and you don't have to look it up if you don't want to. Adam Hamilton says in the Old Testament, there are 80 to 90 references to the Spirit of God. Maybe it's the breath of God that blew across the waters in Genesis 1. I'm always returning to Genesis, but it's kind of the beginning. Or maybe it's the Spirit of God that helps create life, as in Genesis, or the Spirit of God that comes upon and gives wisdom to the leaders. You know, that's why they would anoint leaders, whether it was Moses and all of the judges beyond that and all of the kings, they would be anointed and they would have a laying on of hands so that the Spirit of God would give them the power and the wisdom to be good leaders. Or maybe it's the Spirit that told the prophets about God's heart, about what God's will and God's purpose was, or maybe even God's judgment for the people. You see, the Spirit is working in ways that we can't quantify or even write down sometimes. Except for this one story. Anybody ever heard of the story of Samson? Now, Samson was in the Old Testament. He was a really strong guy, right? But when he would perform these strong human feats, what happened? The Spirit would come upon him and give him the power that he needed. Now, we know the rest of the story, which was there were other things that got him into trouble, and he lost that power. We're going to keep this a G-rated service, so I'm not going to tell you all of that. But instead, to remind us that when Samson did something supernatural or superhuman, it was when the Holy Spirit came upon him. Maybe when you were sharing with your neighbor, you could think of a time that you felt the Spirit or you knew it was God because you knew that it wasn't something that came from you. Going into the New Testament has so many references to the Holy Spirit that I definitely didn't want to count them. Whether you're talking about the Spirit leading Jesus out into the wilderness, or the Spirit, how Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit, which is found in the Luke and also in the Apostles' Creed, but also in the book of Acts. Now, if you were to look in your Bible, and you all brought your Bible today, right? No judgment here. But you all have a Bible in front of you. You don't have to grab it. But mine says the Acts of the Apostles. By the way, Acts is after Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So in case you want to know that. Which, don't you think Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John should be the name of the Beatles? I don't know. That was just something that came through my head. Maybe it was a spirit-given thing. But anyway, the Acts of the Apostles. That's what it's called in many of our Bibles. But it's been said that perhaps it should be called the Acts of the Holy Spirit. Because there are a lot of times in the Acts book where the apostles respond because the Holy Spirit has come upon them. So the next time you read or we're going through scripture, even if we're talking about something else, notice every time we see Holy Spirit and notice what happens. And we'll talk about that in a minute. But the Holy Spirit, especially in the New Testament, the word that's often associated with it is parakaleo, which is in the Greek, paraclete. Have you ever heard paraclete? You ever heard that? If you type paraclete into your computer, it auto-corrects it to parakeet. So I'm not talking about the parakeet. I'm talking about the paraclete. Paraclete, which means called together, or called to be alongside. And there's this understanding that the Holy Spirit is the paraclete. It's the one who is beside us. The one who is encouraging us. The one who is inspiring us. The one who is advocating for us. The one who is speaking with us. The one who walks with us through this life. We believe that God created. We believe that God and Jesus is our Savior, but we believe that God is with us now. Maybe the Spirit is sitting right next to you. Maybe the Spirit is hovering. Maybe the Spirit is in us. So when we start talking about God and we talk about these different aspects and it gets to this idea of the Trinity, I don't want to say that Jesus isn't with us. I don't want to say that God isn't with us. I don't want to say that God the Father created and Jesus didn't, because that's not true either, because the Spirit was there as was the Word, which is Jesus. You get to this understanding, this Trinitarian understanding of God is way confusing. Anybody completely understand it and you want to explain it? Maybe the Spirit's going to ask you to stand up. So when we start laying these terms out, I believe in God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. If you start to say, well, Reverend Laura, doesn't Jesus do that? Well, yes. Well, what about God the Father? Doesn't God the Father also with us and also inspiring us? And well, yes. Bless you. If you can't be blessed in a church when you sneeze, I don't know where you should be. We may not understand God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Or as Adam Hamilton says, he believes that when we get to the hereafter, it will make complete sense. But right now, what brain matter we have doesn't quite understand it. And I like to say sometimes we just have to have faith and believe that God is with us. Believe that God is speaking to us. Believe that that person of God may be what we call the Holy Spirit. Some of you thought about that time that you felt God speaking to you, or you felt a nudging of the Spirit. If we were a truly holiness-based church, I'd invite you all to stand up and share your stories. Anybody have a story that they want to share? I can be that free to the Spirit. My personality profile allows a little bit. What I will share are a couple of stories that Adam Hamilton shared in his book, and then I'll share mine. First, he said, now he's a pastor. He's a pastor of like 10, 20,000 people I think it's 10,000 people in Overland, Kansas. But he's a human being too, and he's a pastor. And so he said there was a member of his church that had just recently gone into the hospice house in their community, and he had visited with them, but one night about 10, 11 o'clock at night, he had this tap on the shoulder that you need to go see, or it wasn't a tap on the shoulder you need to go see, but all of a sudden that person, he just thought about his congregation member, and so he emailed the family member, got no response. He called them, got no response, and then he did what all of us would do, which is, well, I'll call them in the morning and find out what happened. And so, of course, the next morning he wakes up and finds out that that night his congregation member passed away. And he thought, what would have happened if I had responded to that nudging? Because he looked back. Maybe he didn't hear it or didn't recognize it as the Spirit speaking to him at that time, but he looked back and went, I bet that was a nudge, and I didn't respond. Maybe some of you can look back at those times where you felt like doing something, or you felt called to do something, or felt something, and you went, well, nah, that can't be right. I'll check it later, and then you can look back and go, well, maybe that was God speaking to me. The other story is of a member of his church, a young woman who was who had heard that another member of the church had also gone into the hospice house, different person. She wasn't related to this person, but this person was like a mentor to her. And so one night, so now you're going to be wondering, what happens at 10 o'clock at night? But one night she was sitting there and she felt the tap, the nudging that she needed to go see him. And she's like, well, why would I need to go see him? It's 10 o'clock at night. But she didn't question. She just got in her car and drove to the hospice house. She walks in and he's lying in the bed and his wife is asleep in the chair. She didn't wake up the wife. She just sat down, she grabbed his hand, and she just started talking to him and said, it's okay. When it's time, your wife will be fine, your family will be fine, and it's okay if you're ready to go on. Sometime later, his breathing changed. His wife woke up. She took his other hand, and the two of them were with him when he breathed his last breath. And she thought, what an honor to be with him as he left from this world and entered into the next. Only because she listened to the tap of the Spirit in her. Now, perhaps many of us don't have examples that are that dramatic. But has there been a time in our lives when we've just known we needed to do something? Or we just knew that somebody needed encouragement? Or we just knew that we had to do something or not do something? You see, the Holy Spirit is God speaking to us today. Sometimes the Spirit is working through our conscience, saying, this is the right thing to do, or, you know, you're not supposed to be doing that. I won't ask if any of you had those issues. Sometimes the Spirit is speaking to our hearts and saying, you are loved no matter what. That God loves you just as you are. In our Methodist theology, we call that prevenient grace. God's grace is always out there lighting up our consciences, inspiring our own faith so that one day we'll wake up and go, that was God with me, even in that time when I didn't realize it. The Spirit also works through us and among us. And that's where my own story comes from. As I've shared many times before, I didn't grow up going to church, but growing up in the South, I knew a lot. But it wasn't until I was 25 that I was baptized. And probably a year or two after that, I was sitting in the church that I had joined, and it was during the prayer time. You know the prayer time where everybody's quiet? And sometimes your mind wanders, sometimes it doesn't. Well, I wasn't wandering that day, and I was praying, and all of a sudden, I felt this something come upon me. I like to call it like a shiver, like I've got the chills, but I'm not cold. But that was the first time I noticed it during the prayer time in worship. From that point on, I started noticing it, that I felt it at other times. I continue to feel it today. But when do I feel the Spirit the most? It's not when I'm by myself, usually. It's not necessarily when I'm doing my own devotion or my own prayer time, but it's when I'm with other believers, when I'm with the church. Often it's when you hold hands. You know, we hold hands before we eat, or when we're gathered together, and I just feel a tingling. Maybe you felt something like that too. Or I feel it sometimes when I'm speaking and I know that's what God has to say, or sometimes when I'm listening and I know that that's what God wanted me to hear. If you haven't felt that, it's okay. My guess is if there were 200 of us here, there would be 200 different experiences of the Holy Spirit. That's mine. What is yours? Because I believe in prevenient grace, too, that even if we don't understand, even if we're not sure that God is speaking to us, like God is in little baby Emma, even if her parents are trying to keep her from being too distracted, just like God is in my Emma. Or a friend of mine from another church just had another grandbaby whose name is Emma. There are a bazillion Emmas in this world. But God is in each, every one of them. God is in each of us. Sometimes the name we use for God in us, God working through us, is the Holy Spirit. So I'm going to ask you over the next week to notice. Let's see, I think the last few weeks I've asked you to notice God, to pay attention to God, or pay attention to those moments. Now I want you to pay attention not just when God works in you, but I would like to challenge each of us, and I'm going to do it too every morning, whether it's when you first wake up, when it's you do your devotions, or after an hour after you've had your caffeine, whatever works for you. Pray that the Holy Spirit might be present in you and might use you. Maybe that's two different prayers. But pray that the Spirit might be with you, that you might notice it, and then God might use you. He's talking to you back there, so. Holy Spirit, come upon our sound system and our video system. Who's to say that doesn't work? All I know is that God is with us. God is in each of you, and the Spirit is in us. And we're going to talk about that a little bit more next week when we talk about the Holy Spirit and the Holy Catholic Church, little c. So now I believe we're going to profess our faith using the Apostles' Creed, the one that's either on your card or 882 or on the screen. Let us begin. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And now we come to that time that was so meaningful to me, our prayer time. And it continues to be meaningful to me as I grab my cards here. Because there's something about being together. We support one another, we experience God together. The Spirit unites us, but we can also pray for one another. So we have a couple of prayer concerns to share. Continue to pray for Melanie Mork as she deals with her melanoma. She'll go to the doctor this week, Wednesday. Prayers for Bob Wade. He was in the hospital when I saw him on Friday. He was thinking he was going to be coming home. He had something, I think it was something with his back. So I spoke with Nancy, and I'll give her another call. But we pray for Bob, as well as for Nancy. Wanda's back, so we are thankful, and we hope you had good travels. John Gillenwater is currently traveling with the Cheyenne VA Golden Age Games team. I forgot where he said they were traveling to, but we pray for all of them. Also, prayers for Sean Horton as he looks for someone to help him with his PTSD And after speaking with Wendy, pray for all of our first responders that have to deal with a lot, that have to deal with a lot. And then Marin asks that we pray for her friend George Baber, who's in his last days. He hasn't seen his daughter in 28 years, so we pray that she and her two daughters can get to Kimball, Nebraska by his birthday on June 6th. So we pray for that. I'm sure there are other prayers concerned around his situation, and so we offer that. We also pray for those that serve us from our family in our military. We pray for Mark Robbins, Jeff Fossler, Lucas Drake, Caden Sellers, and Monica Gonzalez, and I'm sure there are others that we pray for today. Maybe there is a prayer concern on your hearts, and so maybe the Spirit is nudging you. So let's continue with a moment of silent prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving Spirit, we know you are with us. We feel you as we reach out to one another, as we engage in conversation and hugs, and even with those that we don't know. We know, Spirit, you are with us as you are with these young people that are with us, reminding us that there is life, there is new life wherever we turn. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you might enliven us as individuals and as a church. Lord, we know our lives are not perfect. We struggle. There are difficulties. We have pains that we can't share with other people. Sometimes we don't know what we believe, and so we just turn to you in faith. Sometimes it's blind faith. But yet we trust that you are helping us to grow our faith. You are helping us to nurture our faith. And that you are igniting us to be maybe not on fire for you, but just to be more willing to see you in our world. More willing to tell you, to tell others of you. Gracious God, like the disciples and the apostles in the book of Acts, your Spirit falls upon us. You fall upon us and give us the courage and confidence to speak, to love, to welcome, and to encourage. So we pray this day as the body gathered here, that we might be filled with your Spirit, that others might know that they are loved when they encounter us. And we pray as individuals, Lord, that we might be filled with your Spirit, so that we might see you at work in front of us, and we might join with you in the work of transforming this world, in the work of sharing God's love with others, and in the work of seeing the value in each person. Gracious God, we lift up these prayer concerns, those that are dealing with struggles or end-of-life issues, those that are dealing with illness and diagnosis and recovery, and those of us that have those unspoken prayer concerns, but yet you have heard us because you are with us. And we pray all these things in the name of our Savior, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. And now as we prepare our hearts for communion, let us come together with our confession. Let us prepare our hearts by confessing our sins and brokenness to God, first with a moment of silent prayer for our silent confessions. And as we continue, the next screen? There should be a next screen. So, I tell you what, gracious God, hear the confessions of our hearts. May you have mercy upon us. May you give us new life. As we receive the forgiveness offered to us in your Son, Jesus Christ, and the assurance of faith that your Spirit continues to give to us today. You raise the dead to life in the Spirit. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You bring pardon and peace to the broken in heart. Christ, have mercy. You make one by your Spirit the torn and divided. Lord, have mercy. God has reconciled the world to himself through the death and resurrection of his Son, Jesus Christ, not counting our trespasses against us, but sending the Holy Spirit to shed abroad his love among us. And let us share that peace and that spirit with one another as we offer the peace of Christ with one another at this time. As I was watching little Emma go and receive a hug from one of our congregation members, that reminds us that we are not just a family that's closed, but we are open because God's Spirit is with us. And now is an opportunity for us to give thanks for the many ways that God has blessed us and that we can bless the world with the giving of God's tithes and our offerings as the ushers come forward. Now let us join together in our prayer of dedication. Dear Lord, in your presence, our spirits are renewed. In your wisdom, we discover peace. In fellowship together, we find ways to share your good news with others. As we enjoy your blessings, help us to give from our abundance with glad and generous hearts. We dedicate these tithes and offerings in the name of Jesus and in the power of the Holy Spirit, who keeps us inspired. Amen. And please be seated. As we come together in our time of communion, the sacrament of Holy Communion. You know, if there's one thing we know about the Holy Trinity, it's confusing, but yet God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are everywhere throughout Scripture and even in our time of worship, even in this sacrament. Because this meal before us, much like the meal that Jesus had with his disciples that night that he was betrayed, the bread represents the fruit of the earth. That God sustains us. God has created this creation and called it good and asked us to nurture one another with the food that is provided and with the cup and with the drink, the fruit of the vine. But yet Jesus did something different that night. Instead of just thanking God for creation, Jesus transformed the meal. He took the bread, he asked God to bless it, and then he broke it, as was the custom. But he said, "This is my body, which has been broken for you. Every time you eat, remember me." And in the same way, he took the cup and he asked God to bless it, as was usual. But then he said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink, remember me." We remember the sacrifice that Jesus made. We remember the ways that God has provided for us, but we ask that the Holy Spirit once more make this bread and these cups into the body and blood of Christ, that filled with his presence, Holy Spirit, make us into the body of Christ, redeemed by God's love and sent out into the world to teach the good news of God's love for all. We are transformed by the love of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. May we feel that, may we taste that, and may we be changed by that in this time of Holy Communion. But now, as Christ's disciples, let us pray the words that he taught us, our Lord's Prayer. Our Father. So now I invite those that are helping to serve communion to come this time. You can come and use that. You can come on. Because each of us will be given the opportunity to receive a piece of the bread and dip it into the cup, receiving this sacrament. All are welcome at the table, regardless of whether you're members of this church, whether you're members of any church, or whether you're not sure about any of this. We believe that God can transform you, that the love of Jesus Christ can be present in here in such a way that you might experience it. And so this is the body of Christ broken for you and the blood of Christ shed for you. So come forward as the ushers are led, as the ushers lead you, and receive this holy sacrament. Now let us join together in our prayer after receiving. Loving God, we thank you for feeding us at the supper of your Son. Sustain us with your Spirit, that we may serve you here on earth until our joy is complete in heaven, and we share in the eternal banquet with Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Until that time, when we go from this life to the next, the Spirit is with us. The Spirit will be with us always. May this week we encounter God in a different way, and may we notice. But until then, let us stand and sing our closing hymn, O Spirit of the Living God. It's 539 in your hymnal. If you're looking in the hymnal, it's verses 1 through 3, but they will be on the screen. So let us begin to form that one family as I invite you to hold the hand of the one next to you, uniting us as the church, as the people of God, not walking through life alone, but encouraged, supported, and advocating on behalf of one another. And as we go out into the next week, may the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and always. Amen and amen.